morning prayer in the service of the Lord's Day, the 19th Sunday after Pentecost, the 8th of October, 2023, Community Church of Syosset.
When all the people witnessed the thunder and lightning and the sound of the trumpet and the mountain smoking, they were afraid and trembled and stood at a distance and said to Moses, "You speak to us and we will listen, but do not let God speak to us or we will die." Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid, for God has come only to test you and to put the fear of him upon you so that you do not sin."
Praise the God of all faithfulness.
Thank you.
out of the house of slavery, you shall have no other gods before me.
You shall not make for yourself an idol,
whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth.
You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord.
For the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name.
Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy.
6 days you shall labor and do all your work.
Honor your father and your mother.
So that your days may be long in the land that the Lord is giving you.
You shall not murder.
You shall not commit adultery.
You shall not steal.
You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor.
You shall not covet your neighbor's house.
You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, male or female slave, or ox, or donkey,
or anything that belongs to your neighbor.
Let us worship God. Reconciliation and devoting ourselves to the conversion of the matters of our life. God, for whom all things are possible, we confess it is hard to follow the path you have set before us.
We like to be comfortable.
We want to earn enough money to retire well, to live in ease, and to take care of those we love.
We are good people, God.
We do not hurt others. We are law-abiding citizens. We pay our taxes. Yet, you want more from us?
It seems impossible.
Open our hearts and change us, because most of all,
Jesus, we want to be with you.
Friends, we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses.
But we have one who in every step has been tested as we are, yet without sin.
Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need.
In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Our lesson this morning is a familiar one. It's taken from the 21st chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. We have heard this story of the landlord and the wicked tenants of the vineyard. As we listen to it, let us ask ourselves, what are the tests God might bring into our own lives? Listen to another parable, said Jesus. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then
He leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenant to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his slaves, beat one, killed another, stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, "They will respect my son." They will respect my son. Then, when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves,
"This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance."
So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now, when the owner of the vineyard comes,
what will he do to those tenants?
They said to him,
"He will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at harvest time."
Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in Scripture?
The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes.
Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you
and given to people who produces the fruits of the kingdom."
When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables,
they realized that he was speaking about them.
They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds
because they regarded him as a prophet.
May God bless this holy scripture to our understanding. So when Moses had given the law to the people, you know, the people had heard, that were looking at the mountain, they saw the smoke, they heard the trembling, they heard all that. They were terrified, and they said, "Moses, Moses, don't... You speak to us. We'll listen to you. Don't let God speak to us. You know, we'll die if God speaks to us directly." You know, Moses said to them, "God has come only to test you and to put the fear of God within you so that you do not sin." Right? That's what Moses said to the people. And if you look at it, this was not like a nice, easy test that God had in mind for the people. Because a lot of times I think you and I, and at least I anyway, I don't know about the rest of you, but I suspect most of us, we've gone to school and we've taken tests, haven't we? Robert's even administered a couple. And, you know, maybe we do well, maybe we don't. But have we all, 100% of us, survived those tests? We all, one way or another, whether we got our degree or we got the summa cum laude, we survived them. We survived them. So when we think about tests, you know, that it's when we hear God has come to test you, you know, we think about, okay, this is something that, you know, we prepare for, we study for, we get ready for, we organize ourselves for, and, you know, we'll get through it, and, you know, and we'll take our grade, right? That would be the ordinary way of looking at it. Maybe when the Hebrew people were looking at testing, they didn't quite have the idea of your math exam in mind, okay? Testing took on an entirely different kind of understanding. So to be tested, they might use images rather than the examination paper. They might use the image of being tested in battle. Now, what happens to soldiers when they're tested in battle? Well, some of them live and some of them get killed, don't they? They die. Or you might want to test the metal in the crucible or the furnace. Well, what has to happen to the metal first? It gets melted down and then gets pounded out. And that's how you test it. It's a different kind of testing. There's a more of a gravitas to it. And there's also not the presumption that, you know, you're going to necessarily come out okay. Because let's face it, in Hebrew scriptures, as in all the great myths of the day, heroes often fail, don't they? I mean, that's a big part of the whole idea of the story that's told. Also what we experience. So when we hear God is out to test us, what does the testing do? Whether it's a soldier in battle or a piece of metal, it not only demonstrates whether or not it was worthy before the test, the test changes the thing itself, doesn't it? The soldier is not the same coming out of battle that he was going into it. You know, and you might say the same thing of students. Maybe that's true, maybe it's not. Definitely true of metal. If you're looking for the test of the loaf of bread or the dough, the yeast changes the dough, right? It's change. That's what proves it. The proof is in the change. And if you think about the people that Moses was saying, well, God wants to put the fear of sin on your hearts and he wants to test you. Did any of those people make it into the Holy Land according to the story? No, they didn't. That whole generation passed away and a new generation was born in the desert. That's the story as is told in the book of Moses. So, you know, the people who left Egypt went on a sojourn that they did not survive. God has only come to test you. We look at our own lives as a test. It is a test that none of us will survive in the ordinary sense of the word, right? Every one of us will live out the test of our lives until we die. All of us. Every one of us. Now, we as Christians believe in the resurrection, don't we? And so that we might believe that the truth and the glory and the realization of our life is in the resurrection. But we know that the test of our life and our living lasts as long as we breathe. We know this to be the case. At least I hope we know this to be the case. Because it is. The question is, has the test changed you? Not only does it reveal who you were before the test began, you know, who you were in potentia, I suppose, if you were a baby before your baptism, or your youth before you made a commitment to the Lord, if that's how you take it. But before the test began, by the end of the test, you are entirely transformed and different. So when Moses says this to the people, he says it in terms of be not afraid, right? Be not afraid. Here we have in the scripture the idea of the wicked tenants. Now, obviously, you know, we want to be careful. We don't want anti-Semitism or anything like that to fall into our thinking or thoughts like that. But basically, Jesus was acknowledging, the scripture acknowledges that the Pharisees and the scribes knew that Jesus was talking about him, them, right? They didn't like it, but they wouldn't arrest him because they didn't want the people to get mad at him. Okay, they were afraid of the people, so they didn't arrest him, but they didn't like it. So by given that bit of information, we might look at the whole of this parable as being metaphorical, right? You know, God created a people, just like the landowner planted a vineyard. He set a wall around it, just, okay, the people, the Jewish people, he set apart. He set a wall around it, right? You know, he put in a wine press, the blessings and the work of the day, the place to be. And he put a watchtower, the prophets, to speak to them and to give them warning, correct? So, I mean, you know, all of these things, metaphorically, they just play, you know, in almost an allegory one to the other. And then, the Lord wanted his return. He wanted them to be fruitful and to share that fruit and to dedicate it to God. And we know what happens when his first servants, the prophets, were sent to the people, right? We know what happens to prophets, don't we? Yeah, they get killed for the most part. Prophets have a hard time of it. Now, Jesus understood himself, and the gospel writers understood himself to be the very Son of God. And here we have this parable where the landowner then sends the son. What do? Kill him too, because they want his inheritance. Oh, this had to be hard on folks, right? And then what would that landowner do? Harsh judgment, right? Harsh judgment. And yet, when we remember Jesus, what did Jesus pronounce from the cross? Let's say it together. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. All right. But we'll trust that the Lord our God heard and respected and honored Jesus' appeal for mercy, even for those who would harm him. And, right? We can trust in that. So what if we were, rather than to say, oh, well, the Jewish people of old were really bad, that's why everything went wrong for them, and, you know, they lost out on the blessing. People just say these things. The churches have said these things over time. We don't say that now. Jesus, we believe, asked for God's mercy, and they got it, and they have it. But it does not mean that the testing ceased. And still, the testing goes on, revealing these people and who they are, changing them, hopefully forming them to conform more closely to God. That's what we hope. And what about us? Who here feels that they've been tested in their life? I have. And I expect that if you look at your life as a challenge to reveal who you were made to be, to reveal the precious creature that God wants you to be, to have your place in eternity, to have your inheritance of glory. Well, this life is the test. This life is our test. None of us will survive the test. All of us will have sufferings in the test. Some of us will be very successful in parts of our test. Most of us will work through this test of our lives with a great deal of care, with joy, with love, with beauty, with sorrow, right? This is the test. What Moses says is, be not afraid. Does Jesus say, be not afraid? Multiple times. But that does not mean that the fear of God is not upon us. And a lot of us think that the fear of God means like, oh, I got to watch out because God is going to come and get me if I'm bad. Right? Isn't that how ordinarily we would think of the fear of God? You know, almost like that Santa Claus song, you better watch out, you better not cry, you better not pout, I'm telling you why. You know, judgment day is coming. All right, a lot of people have that thought. That's what the fear of God might mean. But no, the fear of God is to stand in awe of creation, recognizing that God's holy presence, which is maybe frightening, like the people, oh God, Moses, you talk to us, not God directly. Maybe that's frightening, but what that is to not sin, that experience of the awe of God is that we may not sin. Oh, who here is not awed by a baby or a young child or a young life and find themselves devoted, I am going to build up young people all around me, I hope so. Who here is not thrilled by the glories that they see in nature and say, well, I'm going to do what I can to make sure that they last to the next generation. You know, Theodore Roosevelt, the preservationist, because he was awed by it. He saw the forest as more valuable than lumber. Who here has not walked on the beach and seen the families in the beach or the park enjoying themselves and saying, I want to see the public good sustained? The awe that we experience is a part of the test. How will it change us? How will we be faithful to it? You know, when we're inspired by stories of philanthropies or charities or generosity, we all know why people tell that story, right? Because they want us to share in it, usually with our checkbook, but they want us to share in it. That we too can have that sense of God's almighty work happening in the midst of, you know, tragedy or opportunity or beauty in this world. Our test in this life is to open our hearts as much as we can to the God we experience, to those we experience as bringing God's word to us one way or another. This is our test, that in the adversity of life, will we bear it faithfully, as lovingly as we can? Will we accept the help that we need humbly? When we are tested and we see our neighbor in need, and we're rightly in a position to give help, will we give it? When we see a neighbor that we would put at arm's length, will we try to draw closer? Or if we fail in doing that, will we repent? Say, God, I'm so sorry. I put them at arm's length. Help me do better next time. Will we let the tests of our life change us, prove us, that we may be like the proof of the dough, that the yeast has risen, that the yeast of the Holy Spirit, that the leavening of the Holy Spirit might be proof in our lives. That what we start out with is changed, not into rot, but into the bread for the world. Will we be salt or lose it, or will we lose our savor? Will we be light? Will we hide it? Each of us has a unique test before us according to the opportunities that we have. And maybe those opportunities are interacting with the letter carrier or the lady at the grocery store. Or maybe the opportunity is reconciling with someone we've been estranged from. Maybe the opportunity is to continue to walk in faithfulness and seek the best ways, humbly acknowledging we don't know how to make all things right. But in devoting ourselves to love and care for others, we will not sin. And if we let the awe that we feel in God's presence come upon our hearts, we'll be strengthened in our avoidance of sin and in our living out a life of love. May God bless our readings of Holy Scripture to our understanding. Time for joys and testimonies. Could I call on someone else? I mean, I can, but could I call on someone to give a testimony to our concert on Friday night? George?
It was magnificent.
All right. So, yes?
It was absolutely excellent. It was very impressive, very enjoyable. I'm glad we had it.
I am too, and you know, with it rained out and rescheduled, I was so worried that hardly anybody would come, and the turnout wasn't so bad. And it was a really nice service, and you know, it just gave joy to my heart. I'm so glad Alejandro had the chance to come, and you know, he just loves this church, loves this place. To him, it smells like home. It's it was just a delight to have him here, and to hear the recital and have people enjoy it, and inspired people's hearts. And I'm also confident that I want to stand firm, that the recital that he gives, while it's a joy to us and it's a performance for the benefit of the audience, it is to the glory of God, first and foremost. And so we give thanks and praise for his artistry and for his love and for his friendship and for this church having the opportunity and the wherewithal to bring an audience together to join in the fellowship, to join in this this praise for God. So, in thanksgiving for Alejandro's performance here on Friday night, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Are there other testimonies or joys anyone would care to share? Yes, Bill. So for Ginny, now is Ginny having surgery or something? Is that it? Or is
it?
The knee is just not well. Okay. And Cookie, you said, was getting a face. She's the lady that comes for the anniversaries, right?
Yes.
Right. Her husband is getting his.
She had a hip replacement. She's doing well.
Almighty God, we lift up Timmy and Cookie. We just are so thrilled that their procedures went well. Our own Ginny, our hearts just go out to her, and we just pray that her knee heals up and that she can return to being able to move around and get around and enjoy her life as she has been. For these easier servants, Lord, we pray to the Lord. Are there other prayers this morning? Yes, Diane.
A neighbor friend, Debbie, has deteriorated via dementia, and her family has had to put her into a care facility. She has been a lifelong caregiver to her son, her adult son, who is also now placed, I hope, in a good group home, and their dog.
Mighty God, we pray for Debbie as she makes this very difficult transition. Pray for Debbie and her son, because the separation must be very difficult for the both of them. Mighty God, we lift up their needs to you. We pray for the family that has been in a position to make very, very hard decisions. We pray, Almighty God, that you will give your people peace of mind. Help them to accept these tests in these chapters of their lives. We pray to the Lord. We pray for the benefit of the North Shore Animal League, receiving this family's beloved pet. This is precisely what the league is there to help with. And we just pray that as they place this senior dog, that they're able to honor the love that the animal has received all its life. We give thanks for the ministry that they have in the community. We pray to the Lord. Are there other prints? Lauren?
Going back to celebrations, my mom celebrated her 93rd birthday this week.
Yay, 93rd. Will you wish her, give her our heartfelt happy birthday? Oh, thank you. Oh, blessings. For the joys of birthdays, for Thelma and her life, for Jack, who's had a birthday too, just recently, for the joys of life that are around us, that we may celebrate them well, we pray to the Lord. Are there other prayers this morning? Yes, Jack?
I say a prayer for the people of Israel who are under attack.
Almighty God, we pray for the holy lands torn up by war. We pray for repentance of all those who do such terrible harm. We pray for better, more peaceful ways. We pray for all the parties to have the courage and the humility to follow those ways. We pray that this war in the Holy Lands will end soon. We pray for better outcomes for everybody. Remember all the people that have died, both in the attacks and in the retaliations. We pray, Almighty God, that you will retrain our hearts to guard against the killing of innocents, a lesson we have so sorely forgotten. We pray for your help to bring peace in the Holy Lands, in Ukraine, and wherever our warring madness has taken hold in this world. We pray to the Lord. Are there other prayers this morning? Yes, Bill. I think that's appropriate. Ren, yeah. Can we sing Happy Birthday to Jack, please? We have so many prayers. You know the prayers that we offer up. Often you know the prayers that we have in our bulletin. We pray that you will make us more deeply a people of prayer. As we search our hearts, we just have us in very particular. Remember Stan and Vicki Noble since Vicki's passing this past week. Care for his heart. Care for the family, and care for all those who loved her, and for this church community to which she contributed so much for so long. Let us seek our God in the silence of our hearts. So we are bold to pray as our Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Upon you and give you peace. God's people say,
Praise the God of all faithfulness.
Good morning, everyone. Happy birthday also to Carmen Meyer, who is watching from hundreds of miles distant away. So I got that from the little screen here. Please join us now for refreshments provided by Diane Metallis. And on Saturday the 14th, do come by for mums, pumpkins, and music. And I don't know my place yet. Okay, someday I will. So that will be all day next Saturday through the good efforts of George Santos, the pastor, and Michael Dadap. So come next Saturday, we'll be selling pumpkins and mums and providing music outside. And we will see you now for refreshments.
No, I'm going to make an announcement.
Oh, excuse me. Enjoy the day, everyone. We have big plans for Saturday. I made a sketch, and Pastor shared it with the families of the children of the children.
Back up, George. Back up over here so people can see your face.
Oh.
Because they want to do that.
How's that? Is that better?
That's perfect.
Okay. So, and they were all enthusiastic, and they said they were going to be here 8:30 on Saturday to help us. So we're planning on basically a couple of areas. We're going to set up two canopies for the children to play under, and we're going to set some blankets on the ground, hoping it's going to be a lovely day, and some chairs. And then we're going to have a refreshment table in the back, and then we're going to have two separate tables to sell our mums and pumpkins. And if I get ambitious, I will try and have a elephant table to try and get rid of a lot of junk that I have in my basement, and you're welcome to bring stuff. Now brings me to the next point. We have a refreshment table. I have all the water we need, but I need goodies. So there are little snack bags here, and the idea is, you know, you could take a box and fill it with cookies or goldfish or whatever your heart desires, or you can take this off my hands and fill the snack bags and bring them Saturday morning. The idea is we're encouraging people to hang around, not just to buy mums and pumpkins, but to hang around and listen to the children. And we're gonna, you know, give them little snacks and water to encourage them to linger.
Would you like baked goods?
Anything you would like. You know, the idea is put a couple in each of these bags. I got a couple of boxes. And everyone's welcome to take a box and or get one on your own. And I still have another box at home, so I can put stuff in. And anything you would like to bring would nice. The idea is just, you know, a small amount, and so that we're going to have the table in the back. And of course, I'll be here all day. But if you want to come and join us and help us, you know, sit table and set pumpkins or hand out refreshments or whatever, I'm sure we'd be delighted to have you and bring all your friends. And now, that brings to the next point, which is the posters. Where did I put the boxes of all the posters? There are plenty of these. Please take them. If you go to the barber, bring a poster with you. If you go to the drugstore, I even took a poster last week to the bank of the Alexandra concert, and they put it up in the window. So I'm going to visit them again and ask them if they'll put this poster up. We need to get the word out, because if people don't know about the event, we can't expect them to be here. So, you know, and take a little thing of scotch tape with you when you go and say, can I put a poster up in your window? You know, would you like me to do it for you? Because sometimes if you give them the poster, they may get busy and forget to do it. So if you offer to put it up yourself, there's a pile by the front there. There's a pile back here, and I have another pile. So, you know, if you wherever you go, just take one. Or if you feel really ambitious and want to go up and down the street and visit some of the shops and put it up, that would be spectacular, because if people don't know about the event, they ain't going to be here. So please help out if you can with that and with this, and I would be very appreciative. And that's all the news I have.
I just to follow up on what we're doing here, for people who don't know, we want you to come and spend. Yes, of course, we want you to buy a pumpkin or a mum. That's all good. You know. But the main idea here is for us to make good friends with the Children's Orchestra Society, and also for the Children's Orchestra Society to begin doing some things, you know, out and about to show their face to the local community. So to the extent that you can come, that you can tarry, you know, it's not just a fundraiser where you quick run in, buy something and go, and that the main thing is to get to know the Children's Orchestra Society. That's the main thing. So we want to make friends with this event. So it's as much or more a friend-raiser than a fundraiser. And although we expect to do better than break even, just so you know, that's what we're there for. So, and anybody's particularly zealous who decides they want to come on Friday late in the afternoon to help set up, give me a phone call. But or if you want to come at 8:30 in the morning, All good, you know, some of us will be here, we'd love to have it, but mostly in the daytime is the parents of the Children's Orchestra Society are floating in and out and being around in it. There aren't that many things to sell, you know, we just have a few hundred pieces to sell, and I'm sure we're going to be able to make it happen. So so that's what we have going. So next Saturday, okay? Not that we place all of our hopes on it, our hopes is in God, but still, this is a good thing. God bless you all this morning. Thank you, George, so much for your help. Thank you.